oh, beautiful first day this year. Beautiful, beautiful sight here in the house of God. Now, the song I'm going to do, if this band can play the song, I'll take them with me to South Africa. So I'm going to do the song. The song I wrote myself is called My Life is in Your Hands. And my husband has been in ministry for 30 years. And we've been married 16 years now. And I had a lovely time with him, you know, in life. But then life happened 8 years ago. And we went through a very tough time in our ministry where your back is against the wall and there's nothing you can do to make the thing right with your hands, you know, that you can organize or try to rearrange. But I always know that I gave my heart to the Lord because I grew up in church. My father was a full-time preacher. We were 8 children. We used to sleep church, eat church, everything. But then in that time of our lives where we almost lost everything, I decided I'm going to give my life to God. And since I did that, my life has never been the same way. My life has been supernatural, full of miracles. I traveled with my husband and 4 children all across America by faith. And God has never failed me once. Amen. I suggest you do listen to the song and suggest that you do the same. Put your life in God's hands. Sometimes we say, yes, Lord, I give my heart to you, but there's a certain compartment that you still want to. Don't touch this, Lord. Don't touch that. Just give it all to him. It always works out for the good, amen. Give me some drums and some everything.
precious soul. We have 600 members in our church. I'm not telling you that to boast. The reason I'm telling you that is we've left those 600 people. I do not know amongst my friends, pastors that will leave their church for more than two Sundays. They have to rush back. We, years ago, we started in 1983, preached, entered the ministry, started and founded Redemption Center International. The church grew rapidly, and we had 200, 300 members in a very short while. And then we had a Bible school, training our people, and many pastors came out of our local church. I think if I just count, maybe across South Africa and neighboring countries, I can count maybe 50, 60 pastors that came out of our church. I became a community leader in Johannesburg, south of Johannesburg. Became a community leader. It was very volatile years with the struggle against apartheid. You heard of it, you call it apartheid. What do you call it? Apartheid. God bless you. It was worse than hell. Although as I traveled to the USA, I can see how the African American people have suffered. We suffered tremendously. People of color suffered tremendously in South Africa. There was very volatile years. You know, some people, they want to know, how come you light in complexion? Well, my cousins are different colors. We've got, in our family, where we grew up, we had dark brown chocolates and light brown chocolates. It's one family. So we were all under oppression. Some people here in the States, they think my wife is Hispanic and myself, but she herself suffered through the struggle. She got arrested for one day, so she got to pay the dues. So I was a community leader. I brought peace amongst the different political parties. I want to show you something. So you must understand, to be able to bring together in a volatile, almost like a civil war situation, to bring the political parties around one table, God had to deal with you.
Yes.
They had AK-47 machine guns. And God, I went in there, one lady cried when I went in the crowd to see when am I going to come out of that crowd. But we were raised up in the community. And then in South Africa, we had, there's about 400 churches that fellowship together. They are called the International Fellowship of Christian Churches. I was on the executive of this group. I wrote the constitution for them, and I played a leading role. our church grew to about 1,000 people. And I was God's man in faith and power for the hour. Some people would say. And out of that church, we established about 10 other churches. Some of the people, we sent them with pastors. I myself went to start another church. And we have churches we started further afield. A number of churches that we were nurturing. And in the year 2000, 1999, we started these churches. And through covetousness, from the minister's side, the ones that were in the churches, they thought that, you know, there, on their eyes, if you went to look closely in their eyes, you could see signs, horrible signs in their eyes. And they thought they were going to get rich through the church. But they were deceived. Because you yourself know what church work is. And so we started this church and things went well. I was right on top in the nation with the leading pastors. I could correct them, I could rebuke them. Even the strongest of the biggest churches, they respected me. And then these churches that we started, in a moment of madness, they broke away. Because they themselves can't understand what they did. In a moment of madness, they broke away. And when I returned to the original church, the mother church, everyone had departed through slander and lies. And myself and my wife, when the song was birthed out and she just sang, we were left with 8 people and 500,000 in our money rains debt. Not directly converting it, but it could be in your monies, it can also be maybe worth about $200,000 in there, dollars for us to pay. We had nothing left. I was building a house, my house stood still. People began to laugh at us. Children of these rebels would giggle when we came down the street. We had nothing. I don't know how we got to church. My BMW, old BMW, was smoking all the way. When we were phoned by our debtors, people that we owe money, I would just answer the phone and say, no speak any English. People departed out of our lives. I don't know how to describe describe that weakness and that groan I felt inside of me. When people spoke of their churches and how God was blessing them, I felt like closing up shop. I felt, oh, I think I must give up this whole business of church. And I began, as time went along, as we struggled from 2003, 2004, 2005, and I think 2006. Our church used to grow from 40 people to 80 and break down again to 50. And then it used to grow up again to 90, come back to 40. It seemed like the people would come in and leave. One, I heard one person who was gossiping about us. I heard that person say, do you notice whatever Pastor George Ryland does breaks down, never increases. They started saying that he's a good teacher but a poor pastor. And he's not a good leader. Friends of ours used to speak in front of us about another prosperous pastor down the road and said, that is the way you must do things. And they used to say to us, do you know that so-and-so, Pastor so-and-so, has got the latest BMW? I thought, well, let me just close up this thing. I was very close to discouragement. I felt that, discouragement was so close. And I've never really been discouraged in my life. I never gave into it. But we continued. Eventually, I came to a place where the devil began to convince me, after all, you must be just a mediocre pastor. Now face the truth. Nothing big is going to happen in your ministry anymore. You need to have events from time to time and mark time. And you'll have a good retirement when you're 70 years old. People will honor you. Just accept it. And then I actually heard the voice of the devil saying, what about getting yourself a job? And your children are still very young. And I thought to myself, what is the devil? But I was just confirmed a few days later when another man came to me and said to me, why don't you get yourself a job? Your children are still very young. And I thought, oh my God, this is the devil speaking to me also. One day I went into my room and I prayed and I said, oh my God, speak to us. As I finished that prayer, my wife was in the kitchen when she heard an audible voice saying, come apart. And so I myself had already separated myself. The Lord said, come apart. So we went and we began to pray. Then God said, pray in tongues for 2 hours every day. Now I came in 2011, 2012, and 2013 to the USA. And this is the only message I preached. Pray in tongues for 2 hours every day. Now, I used to pray in tongues over the years, but it was sporadic. I would pray all day in tongues today, and next day I forget about it. pray a few minutes in tongues, I'll pray in tongues in the car. But now it was to be a concentrated, focused,